integrity or death, that is my credo, not my ego. Dressed in a tuxedo, into party, alter ego. Killed your leader in gazebo, did it for the people. Love what motivated, I did not do it for hatred. But I truly hate the devil, I cannot debate or fake it. I was asked a question and the asker thought it hard. If I was facing death and I could ask one thing of God, I would ask for every to be free here and abroad. And to be rightfully celebrated as a child of God. And to be rightfully celebrated as a child of God.
KBLA Talk 1580, Ramadan Mubarak. Welcome to our deep, deep dive today. We have with me live in studio, go to KBLA 1580 on YouTube. You know him as Preach, the lovable bad boy on All American. He's a rising star on CW's number one show. It's called All American. You know, he's a fan favorite, known for SWAT, NCIS, for The Love of Jason, that series on ALLBLK streaming network. And you've been in this business a long time.
Yes.
For a young man.
Yes.
Kareem Grimes, welcome.
Thank you for having me, Ms. Dominique DiPrima. It is a honor and a pleasure. Like I told you before off air, I've been listening to you for quite a while, and you've been very informative of what's been going on in the world and in the black community. So thank you. It's a pleasure to be
here. I appreciate that. And of course, that means you're a true Angelino.
Absolutely. Right? Born and raised in Inglewood, California.
Inglewood.
Yeah.
What?
City of champs.
Okay.
Grew up right back here in Leimert Park area. So, you know, I've been around when, you know, John Singleton's office and the Black Bakery.
Is that how you got your break?
Yes, yes.
Whatever a break is. It's
right,
like
right.
You need a break a week
right,
in Hollywood,
right,
but,
right.
You know.
So, yeah, my first film was Boyz in the Hood, John Singleton.
Iconic.
Rest in peace, iconic.
Yes.
I was an extra, and we're probably like 2 weeks into shooting. We're throwing the ball around lunch, and, you know, there's a bunch of other kids, so John's talking to us, and, you know, he saw something in me and was like, hey, I'm going to give you some lines. Are you cool with that? And I was like, yeah, and that was the spark that I needed. So that was how I got into SAG, and you know, that's how I began my journey as an actor, and I've been doing it ever since.
You've been saying lines ever since.
I've been saying lines ever since. Absolutely, indeed.
Yeah, and you know, there's so many platforms now. There's so many different. I mean, I feel like there's been an expansion of what actors are allowed to do, especially black actors.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. I think, you know, with platforms like ALLBLK, you got BET+, BET+Her. It is a lot more opportunity out there for people of color. Coming up in this business, it wasn't a lot. You had your major networks, but, you know, they maybe let one or two in. But this time, you know, we have, like you said, the platforms and amazing people, writers and directors and creatives, Issa Rae, you know, Ava DuVernay, Prentice Penny, the list goes on and on and on, Donald Glover. So, you know, it's allowing us people of color to be able to, you know, tell our stories the way we want to tell them. You know? So, yeah.
And you get to do different roles.
Yes.
You know, when I first came here, I was doing a lot of auditioning and stuff. I can't tell you how many times people were like, you need to sound more black.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
what does that mean? Right.
You're just talking about how the character you have, you know, on All American has seen a real journey.
Yes.
Or what we call a character arc.
Arc. Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely. Preach came in kind of like the end of season one. He was really just kind of like a muscle man for Tyrone, who's played by Demetrius Shipp, and watching Coop, just making sure that she was, you know, staying on point with the business. And that relationship evolved, and, you know, you started to see some layers being peeled back on Preach and what he's all about. And, you know, very smart guy, read a lot of Greek mythology, so he quoted a lot of Greek mythology. He saw something in Coop. And just became kind of like that mentor, that big brother. And, you know, that then evolved to him managing her career as an artist and trying to steer her in the right direction and avoid pitfalls. And, you know, then he finds himself in jail. And from jail, he gets out and is trying to rewrite his wrongs, finding out that he has a daughter now. And trying to make up for that time,
I mean, that's like an actor's dream, right? You get to go from one extreme to the other. And certainly as a black man in Hollywood, you're not always allowed subtlety. You're not always allowed evolution. So how's that feeling for vulnerability?
Vulnerability. You know, him finding out that he had a daughter, you know, you get to see this black man who's like, hey, listen, I got some work to do. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to run away from my responsibilities. I'm going to take it full on. And I'm going to be a father to my daughter, which is important. And I think we don't get enough, or we don't see enough of that, black men fighting for their kids. And in this show, which is, you know, head by Nkeche Okoro, who is the showrunner, African-American woman, you know, so she leads from the top and it trickles down. And just to tell these stories is such an amazing platform to do it. And I've just been blessed and honored. You know, I say it every day, you know, to be able to do what I do is a blessing. So you'll never hear me complain, even though we hear these things on these Hollywood sets and these people are divas and things of that nature. I'm in my element, and I'm just grateful.
Well, and you got your first lines in Boyz in the Hood, which is 1991.
Yes.
Here it is 2023.
Yes.
You're still working.
Yes.
And you shared with me that you're currently filming your first show as a lead.
Yes. So
I mean, first film.
Film as a lead. It's a thriller, and it's going to be on BET+. I'm super excited, and, you know, I think this is just a perfect opportunity for people to just see that, yes, I can lead a film, you know?
But, I mean, I put it in context of, of Boyz in the Hood because, you know, we always think of one, the overnight sensation, and what you said, which is, you know, you've been working steadily.
Yeah.
And over a period, a trajectory from 1991 to now,
yes,
you are starring in your first movie as a leading man.
Yes.
So that takes a kind of patience and steadiness of character and craft that, you know, maybe everybody doesn't have.
Yeah, it's a process. You know, I tell people to you have to embrace and believe in the process. And, you know, there's no overnight success with me. You know, I tell people, listen, I started in 88. You know, some people that I run into, they're like, man, I wasn't even born. So for me, it's just been a journey. And I think through it all, you know, my mom has been and family have been such a support system for me.
Shout out to your mom.
Yeah,
by
shout
the way.
Out to my mom.
Thank you for Jackie introducing Kareem Webb to Kareem Grimes, excuse me, to Front Page.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank
Listen,
you,
my
Ms.
mom,
Grimes.
My mom keeps KJLH on. Whether it's in the house, on her cell phone.
Hopefully she'll check out
KBLA. Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
I love that, though.
Yeah, so, but yeah, she's been such a major figure as just a support system and, you know, just a, you know, champion for me. So, you know, for me, it's just going out there to make her proud.
Now, we're talking with Kareem Grimes. He's an actor. When we come forward, I want to talk about, you know, your craft. I mean, I know that's kind of a cliche, but I think sometimes we look at the product and not enough at the process,
right?
As you talked about, and your side hustles. You got side hustles to the side hustles.
Yes, yes.
Kareem Grimes is in the tech space.
Yes.
As well as in the acting space. All that and more when we come forward on KBLA Talk 1580.
Say the quiet part out loud. KBLA Talk 1580.
Law Office of Jay Black now understands the stress and anxiety that comes with legal issues. That's why we support the right to a fair trial for Los Angeles Councilmember Mark Willie Thomas. Do you have a criminal or civil rights matter? If so, please give us a call at 310-469-9117.
California is a great place to live and work, but those aren't easy things to do for students also going to college. That's why the state created the Californians for All College Corps, a way for students to build skills and help others while earning up to $10,000 for school. Commit to serve your community and we'll help you pay for college. Spots will fill up fast, so learn more and apply today at www.cacollegecorps.com. That's www.cacollegecorps.com. California is a great place to live and work, but those aren't easy things to do for students also going to college. That's why the state created the Californians for All College Corps, a way for students to build skills and help others while earning up to $10,000 for school. Commit to serve your community and we'll help you pay for college. Spots will fill up fast, so learn more and apply today at www.cacollegecorps.com. That's www.cacollegecorps.com.
Chase loves soccer.
I'm Chase Greer, and I'm 12 years old.
And his dream is to turn pro. That's why Chase and his family make sure he's always having fun and squeezing out his best with Go-Go Squeeze.
Okay, buddy, let's break for a Go-Go Squeeze.
Go-Go Squeeze Fruit on the Go pouches are a nutritious snack made from 100% fruit with no sugar added.
That's my boy!
Because when you nurture your kids, you squeeze out the best in them. Squeeze out the best with Go-Go Squeeze. Not a low-calorie food. Products range from 11 to 13 grams of sugar and 60 to 70 calories per serving.
Hey, Dad, how do airplanes fly? What's in this box? Is this tree good for climbing? How are babies made? What does this thing do?
Kids are curious about everything, including guns. Talking to them about gun safety in your home is a good first step, but you can do more. Always keep your guns locked, unloaded, and stored separately from ammunition. Safe gun storage saves lives. Learn how to make your home safer at nfamilyfire.org. That's nfamilyfire.org. Brought to you by NFamily Fire, Brady, and the Ad Council.
Thanks for waking up with Dominique DiPrima on KBLA Talk 1580.
Yeah, thanks for waking up with Dominique DiPrima and actor Kareem Grimes, who, like most black business persons, has a side hustle to the side hustle, as if he's not busy enough with all of the television shows and movies. You do apps and things. You work in the tech space.
Yes. I have dib and dabbed in a tech space. I have an app now, out now, called FacePop. It's on iOS only, along with my partners, Bervic J. Deculus and Jerome Henry. And then I also have another app called Trousseau with Matthew Newman, Sway Calloway, Terrell Owens,
Great company you're in. Shout out to Sway.
Yeah, big shout out to Sway. That's family
Sway
right there.
Sway from the Bay, yeah. Yes. Absolutely.
And Mickey Barber as well. She's also a partner.
Now, that one's
well.
It's like a social media platform.
Yes, social media
coming
platform.
Coming soon.
Yes. Yeah, we are working diligently and we are working hard.
That's a tall order, but wishing you the best with that.
Thank you.
We see the president's flop.
Right.
But, you know, but hey, just because the president couldn't do it doesn't mean you can't.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's just, you know, an interest, or it's, you know.
Yeah, I think for me.
A money thing.
No, it's you know, when they say when you surround yourself with people, you get, it's about surrounding yourself with incredible people smarter than you. That'll kind of push you. And my god brother at the time was starting a golf app because he kept getting cheated. So being around him and seeing the process, big shout out to Calvin, Valerie, seeing the process, I got inspired. We got inspired. My friend Bervic and I, and our first app was FacePop. And, you know, coming from the golden era of hip hop, we were just like, yo, let's create something that's, you know, that's dope, that, you know, that everybody can get involved with. And, you know, we're in my boy's room just chopping it up, and I see, you know, Tribe Called Quest, Midnight Marauders, where all the rappers' heads. And I was like, man, what if we can do talking heads and send them in a text message? Ding, idea. And that's how we got started, and it's just been snowballing ever since.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
You know, I don't know if you heard last hour, we're just talking about how we need more black minds in the tech
space,
especially with AI and everything and the built-in bias. How do we counteract that? And I think it's probably by being there, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we have to get involved. I think we have to push kids into, you know, coding and learning about, you know, AI, because I was reading, you know, 2056, you know, the median for black families are going to be zero, because AI is going to be taking those jobs away. So I think we have to push, you know, technology on the kids. I mean, kids like,
and
you
old
know,
folks too.
Yeah, and old folks
I'm
too.
I'm big on that. Like, we always want the kids to do everything. Some of us need to step up.
Right. Yeah, I have to help my mom, you know, get on Zoom from time to time.
Oh, Lord.
And things that nature.
I know how to get on Zoom.
Right.
But just the reason I'm saying, oh, Lord, is because my son is like, Mom, I am not your IT department.
Right.
Well, actually, son.
You are, right? indeed.
How does it feel to have your career blowing up after so many years in the business?
Man, it's you know, I try to stay present and take it one day at a time. I'm still, you know, my friends are like, man, you're a star, you're a TV star. And it's just like, for me, because I'm just so much about the work, so much about the craft. But I'm constantly reminded every time I go out, whether I work out or, you know, just handling day-to-day business, you know, people come up to me and be like, oh my God, you're Preach from All American, you know, can I take a picture? Or I love that show. So I'm constantly reminded, and it's just a blessing. You know, I think we've heard the stories of, you know, actors who, you know, got into a position and, you know, something has happened, whether it's drugs or, you know, just run-ins and things of that nature. So for me, I'm just grateful and blessed to be in this position. And I just don't take it for granted, because it's been a long journey. So I think when you've gone through the trials and tribulations that I've gone through, you tend to appreciate the little things, and you tend to appreciate it more. And you don't want to mess it up. Yeah. You know, so.
Yeah. I think it's exactly right. The trials and tribulations. Paul Mooney used to call it the illusion of inclusion.
Listen, and Paul Mooney was one of my favorite comedians.
Same.
Like, I put him on the Mount Rushmore of comedians. Love Paul Mooney.
Okay. Who else was on the round? Okay. No.
Yeah. Right.
You're taking me down a rabbit hole. But you said you love the craft.
Yes.
So what does that mean to you? How do you make yourself better? How do you make yourself great?
I think just being a student of the game, you know, studying the greats. I started right over here, actually at Marla Gibbs acting class.
Nice.
So big shout out to Marla Gibbs and Angela Gibbs. That's my foundation. You know, my first acting teacher was Whitman Mayo, for those who, you know Grady from Sanford and Son.
Oh,
you know,
who was great.
Ed, yes, and Ed Cambridge. So, you know, I stand on their shoulders, you know. So, you know, starting at a young age and really understanding, you know, the craft of it, and, you know, dancing. Lady Walker was my dance teacher, who was Ben Vereen's sister, you know.
Wow.
So I'm learning, you know, the Catherine Dunham technique.
Yeah, right?
You know, stage combat, you know, and... You know, so that for me is just, it's all about the craft. It's, you know, I tell people, you know, I'll get on YouTube and I'll look up, you know, people that I admire, and I'll watch interviews, you know, actors on actors and the round table and things of that nature, because I'm constantly learning, you know, and just being a student of the game. And I think when you have that mindset, you know, you there is no ceiling. You know, you can only get better.
So you study still?
Yeah, absolutely.
After decades in the game?
Absolutely.
Yeah, because not everyone does that.
Yeah.
But you also teach. I see you got industry workshops.
Yeah, going on. I did an industry workshop. Big shout out to Matthew Newman at All In Co-Working. He has a space for people to come and work out in Inglewood, California. And it's kind of like a WeWork. And he allowed me to, hold a workshop, because I get DMs all the time. Man, I want to be an actor. How can I get into this? How can I get into that?
Right, I bet.
Oh my gosh.
Everybody wants a hookup.
Man, can you get me on All American? I'm not a casting director.
There's no such thing as a hookup.
There's no like
unless you're actually hooking.
Right.
And even then.
Right, but just just trying to give back. I think once you've attained, you know, some information, I think it's your duty to be able to give back and spread that information out. So that's what I did, and you know, it was very good. I had a good time, and you know, people are asking me to do another one, so you know, we'll see.
You're going to South Africa next month?
Yes, hopefully. And that's the thing about this business.
It's like yes. It means you got
my plane ticket.
You got to wrap the movie before you
got to wrap the movie, and then you know I'm up for two other movies. So it's just like,
so you're kind of hoping to go to South Africa, kind of hoping not to go to South Africa.
Because at the end of the day,
means you have more movies.
Yes, at the end of the day, I can always go to Africa. You know,
you can.
I can always go to Africa, and be able to enjoy it and spend money. Yeah. You know, without having an account. Okay, hold on. Wait a minute.
I always spend money when I go there. Yeah, we're going in June. That's why. Nice. But All American's been renewed. After five seasons, you're doing season six
yes.
for sure.
Yes.
That's great news, right?
Season six,
right?
We're renewed.
Six seasons is long. It's a long run for a show, isn't it?
Listen, most TV shows get 4 to 5.
Really?
You know what I'm saying? So, just like I said, just
blessed. If they're lucky.
Yeah, if they're lucky. If they're lucky. So, we're blessed to get renewed for season six and super excited. And, yeah.
What else do you want to do that you haven't done yet? I mean, you know, as an actor, but as an entrepreneur also.
That's a good question. I mean, to be honest, I think, you know, being in the tech space, just to be able to employ people of color, you know, to reach back and, you know, give, you know, those opportunities that, you know, we weren't given in the tech space, to be able to reach back and say, oh, you have an idea or you have a business plan. Okay, let me go on and fund and seed that, you know, project and watch that grow. So I think that's one of the biggest, that's one of the biggest goals that I have as far as that I want to accomplish. And then, of course, in the entertainment industry, to be able to provide jobs, you know, put people in positions to win. I think that's what it's all about.
Okay. What is this obsession with the
Volkswagen?
The Volkswagen bus.
Yeah. So that is. So listen, you know, everybody has their old school cars, right?
Right, right, right.
Everybody's, you know, L.A. is about the 6.4s, you know, the Chevelles, the Super Sports. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. For me, it was a, you know, Volkswagen 21-23 window bus. You know, that's my old school.
I'm not mad at that.
You know what I mean? We're in California, you know? So for me, that's what it was. And I was, you know, blessed to be able to find one. And I bought it and shipped it back to Los Angeles. And it's like my weekend car. It's like my, you know, getaway, you know, hit the beach, you know.
It's a hobby. It looks like pretty clear.
Yeah, yeah. It's very fun. You know, get a lot of looks, a lot of stares, thumbs up. And but yeah, you know, I enjoy it, you know. But I tell people it's a blessing to be able to afford it. And, you know, I'm not attached to it. You know, somebody is like, hey, how much you want for it? And, you know,
right.
Listen, I'll let it go because I know I can get another one. But yeah, I love it. It's just it's kind of like my little getaway.
It sounds like, just to circle back to All American for a second, It sounds like that show is really resonating for people. It's a hit.
Yes.
Right? It's a hit show.
Absolutely.
Six seasons in.
Mm-hmm.
And the character is iconic enough for people to be stopping you on the street.
Yeah.
I'm wondering, you being an Angeleno, like a real, you know, guy from the community here, how does that play into Preach and the whole vibe that you're able to create on that show?
It plays into it a lot because Preach is a culmination of guys, men that have mentored me in the neighborhood. You know, I don't have a story of Dominique. I came up rough and I was gang banging and this and that. I think I gang banged for 24 hours, you know what I'm saying? And that was it. And, you know, it's guys that, you know, that I grew up in, that grew up in my neighborhood that kept me away from that, you know? So this is kind of like me paying my homage to them to say, hey, thank you. You know, my life could have went a whole different path, you know, but I think Preach embodies the brothers in the neighborhood who, you know, who have gang banged, but who have learned from that and just rewriting their wrongs and you know, definitely helping the community and being a part of it. So this is, you know, this is to say, hey, we see you, brother. Here's a character that that embodies who you guys are. So it plays a big part, you know, and these guys that have helped me, who were once in the street, I still keep in contact with. You know, so, and I let them know every time. I say, you know, this is, you know, in that scene I did that, that's something
dope.
I learned from you.
Yeah, that's dope. Well, yeah. You know, of course you can follow him on Instagram. I just did Kareem Grimes. Got a lot of people following you.
Yeah, a lot of people. I mean, like I said, it's you know, the show has definitely garnered a lot of attention, and you know, like I said, I'm just grateful for it. I don't take it for granted, and you know, I try to respond back to people on Instagram as much as I can. Right now I'm kind of locked in, just, you know, doing this film, but you know, I try to definitely, you know, touch the people, because you know, they took time out of their day to hit me up, send a message. So it's only right that I can respond back and you know, let them know, hey, I see you and thank you.
Well, Kareem Grimes, we appreciate you coming live and
thank
in person
you.
And on YouTube.
Absolutely.
Much continued success.
Yes.
Hopefully we'll check in with you, maybe either by phone or in person when your film hits.
Yeah, absolutely. Listen, I'm in the neighborhood. So this is a hop, jump, and a skip away. So, you know, I'm definitely be back to KBLA 1580 AM. Absolutely.
Absolutely. And once again, hugs to your mom. Thanks for getting your son on board with this black radio
Absolutely.
Think tank situation.
Yes, indeed.
Kareem
Absolutely.
Grimes, thanks so much.
Thank you so much.
Hey, we are going to talk a little bit more in depth about that crazy situation in Virginia. What's going on with the quest to end police associations? BLMLA's Dr. Melina Abdullah is next on KBLA Talk 1580.
More of First Things First with Dominique DiPrima when we come forward.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Mike Moore. Here's the latest from the Black Information Network. In Memphis, Tennessee, a registered sex offender is being accused of murder. Cops booked African-American D'Angelo Bridges in the Shelby County Jail earlier this week on charges of first-degree murder, abuse of a corpse, theft, and tampering with evidence. The 36-year-old is believed to have taken an Uber to 19-year-old Talia Hilliard's apartment before killing her and trying to clean up her body with soap. Florida lawmakers are advancing a bill that would expand the law critics call Don't Say Gay. It restricts teaching about sexual orientation or gender identity in kindergarten through third grade. On Tuesday, a Senate committee in the Republican-controlled legislature conducted a hearing on a bill that would extend those restrictions through the eighth grade. And that's the latest. I'm Mike Moore from your 24/7 news source, the Black Information Network and BINnews.com.
Still got the slated in downtown LA, 110 southbound at Olympic Boulevard. Only the right-hand lane is open because of a fatal crash and traffic stops at the I-5. Also had a fatal crash in the City of Industry, 60 westbound at Crossroads Parkway. Only the right lane open there, and that's a mess from Lemon Avenue. And they're trying to clear for crash now in Silver Lake on the 5 southbound near Fletcher Drive. Left lane taken away by the crash, the 5 extra heavy starting back at Colorado Street. They're trying to repair a pothole block in the right-hand lane on the 210 westbound at Baldwin Avenue. That's a tough drive from Buena Vista Street.
Hi, I'm Kyle at Blindster.com. If you're like many people, you may think custom blinds is a job for expensive professionals. Well, at Blindster, if you have a tape measure and a screwdriver, you can install our custom blinds and save big. Plus, we guarantee they'll fit. Blindster.com.
This is the KBLA Sports Minute with Ray Richardson.
The Clippers lose by one last night to Oklahoma City, but the team has a much deeper concern. Paul George had to be carried to the locker room after injuring his right knee. George's knee buckled when he collided with OKC's Luke Dort while battling for a rebound. The Clippers hope to know more about PG's injury later today. UCLA's men's basketball team arrived in Las Vegas yesterday to prepare for the West Regional Finals in the NCAA tournament. UCLA plays Gonzaga Thursday night, 6:45 p.m. tip-off on CBS. No debates, no speculation, just the info you need. That's your KBLA Sports Minute. I'm Ray Richardson. This sports report was brought to you by Original Taco Pete.
It's Aaron from Original Taco Pete. Let us cater your March Madness munchies. Order with us at Original Taco Pete on Grubhub, Uber Eats, DoorDash, or stop into our Slauson and Crenshaw location. We'll feed you soon.
KBLA Talk 1580. We've got a whole lot to talk about.
Hi, Maisha Cairo here, KBLA, live at Chase Bank on Crenshaw and Vernon for the In This Together tour with female business owners, a day of empowerment, community panels, and best of all, tips on building business from marketing to capital. I'm here with Lisa Stevens, senior business consultant with Chase for Business. Lisa, what's one tip you'd give to business owners here in the Crenshaw area?
I love that you ask that question. I'm originally from Brooklyn, and I grew up in an area that's very similar to Crenshaw. So this this is near and dear to my heart. And if I could only leave a business owner with one, just one, I would tell the business owner to identify their why. And I think that is so important, because your why is going to be that strength on those days where you feel like you're struggling. Your why is going to be that stepping stone. Those days that you want to give up, your why is going to be the reason that you get back up.
And how would you advise business owners looking to acquire capital? What do they need to know before stepping inside the branch to ask for funding?
So three things. I do want to share this when it comes to the power of capital and just finding those resources. Understand that capital is a three part of a business, right? It's not always about the monetary piece, but if you first put that intellectual, right? What do I need to know? That social, who I need to know? That will help you to then package for that monetary piece. So no matter who you're banking with, you should know your banker. Never walk into a bank and you're transactional only.
It's just like Lisa to drop gems. I'm Aisha Cairo in the community for KBLA with JP Morgan Chase.
Congratulations to Revolution Company for being this week's winner of KBLA's Office of the Week. Log on to KBLA1580.com to enter your office to win lunch for 10, delivered by John O'Groats Family Restaurant. The Los Angeles Urban League and Parkside Economic Development Corporation are working to close the wealth gap between black and white households. BWARP, the Black Wealth Attainment and Retention Program's free virtual workshops will help your family acquire, gain, maintain, and pass down legacy wealth. Learn from the experts about making more with what you have, the black history of money, joining the Smart Investors Club, preserving your assets in tough times, crypto, cash in or cash out, the wealthy mind and body. Register for this free series that could change your financial future at laul.org/BWAARP. Don't miss BWARP, the Black Wealth Attainment and Retention Program, every second and fourth Thursday in February, March, and April at 6 p.m. Pacific Time. Register now at laul.org/BWAARP.
Some people won't give you the real talk on drugs, but it's time we know the facts. Fentanyl is killing people. It's a powerful opioid, often made illegally and commonly mixed with illicit drugs. It can even be pressed into counterfeit pills that resemble prescription medications. Just 2 milligrams, about the size of a few grains of sand, could potentially be lethal. This isn't an ad to scare you, but it is an ad to make you think twice. Get the facts. Go to realdealonfentanyl.com. This message is brought to you by the Ad Council.
Broadcasting live from Lombard Park, USA. Welcome back to your home for unapologetically progressive radio. KBLA Talk 1580.
Man, the storm is real. I got friends in the Bay calling me, texting me, telling me they have no power. People's houses sliding down, mudslides down the hill in L.A. And we got more of it today. Please be safe. If you can stay home, stay home. I guess it's supposed to chill out by tomorrow morning, at least for a couple days. So much to unpack, so much going on, and I appreciate my colleague here on KBLA Talk 1580. She has a show Saturday mornings, also airs Sundays, 8 to 10 on Saturdays. This is not a drill. She is the leader of Black Lives Matter Grassroots and a lead organizer with BLM LA, as well as a professor and a mother, Dr. Melina Abdullah. Welcome.
Hey, Sister Dominique. Thanks for having me.
Yeah,
it's actually sunny here. It's sunny off of Crenshaw with some birds chirping and everything.
So yeah, don't get used to it. We had I think we had an hour or two like that yesterday too, and then all of a sudden here comes, you know, the monsoon, as I like to call it.
Yeah. Well,
you guys doing all right though? Yeah, you guys doing all right? Yeah, because. Well, I know today's Wednesday, which means Black Lives Matter LA will be downtown protesting for what it's been quite some time, many, many weeks.
More than 2 years now.
2 years?
And I think it's 107 weeks we're at. 107, 108 weeks we're at now.
Wow.
Yes, and so we're protesting against police associations, which... you know, sometimes infiltrate the union movement. We know that real labor organizers, real unions are out on strike today, right? SEIU 99 is a real union. UTLA is a real union. My union, the California Faculty Association, is a real union because we fight for the rights of working people. But police associations only fight for their own narrow interests. They you know, tape for killer cops. They bully and bribe elected officials, and they pilfer the public purse, meaning that they gobble up more than half of the city's general fund, put it into policing, and in that regard, they deny the city services that are desperately needed. And I don't mean to talk too long, but yesterday I was at police commission meeting, and one of the things that the police chief, who should not be police chief, Michael Moore, was saying is that there are sometimes overdoses on public transportation, and that's why they need more cops on trains. Well, you know what I would like on trains, Ben? I would like paramedics on trains, because they're actually trained to attend to people who are having overdoses, right? So we need to think about where we put our city resources, and we need to challenge these police associations that have so much power, undue power, and instead say that the people should have the power.
Right, so that protest is going on today in across the street from the police association, and all are invited.
Yes. So we are there every Wednesday. This Wednesday is going to be a particularly fun Wednesday. 4 p.m. at 1313 West 8th Street. 1313 West 8th Street. And people might be going, what do you mean fun? It's a protest. Look, we believe protesting should be fun. And so Project Knucklehead is coming out, and we're going to do some community drumming. We'll drum down and chant down the Police Protective League, and we'll, you know, have fun and build community, sing some songs, but also say some things that remind us that, again, the people have the power. So that's today, 4 p.m., 1313 West 8th Street. And we'll have snacks. If it's raining, you'll get a good cup of tea, cup of coffee, donut, all of that is free. And you'll meet some really cool people.
I should have started off the conversation by saying Ramadan Mubarak, Dr. Abdullah.
Thank you. Ramadan Kareem. And we'll start fasting tomorrow. So, yes, looking forward. This season is a blessed season and actually compels Muslims around the world to do the work of Allah and do the work of justice. You know, that's one of the things that Ramadan pulls us into, is committing ourselves to justice work.
So then it is a month of that, you know, fasting, praying. And then the last day or the ending of Ramadan is Eid, right?
Yes. Celebration, a worldwide celebration. But for the entire month, I think Muslims, and sometimes there's people who don't identify as Muslim but fast with us and observe Ramadan with us, the entire month is really, it's the most sacred month in Islam, and it pulls us together. What starts to happen as you deny your body is you really enrich your spirit and deepen your love for God and for the people. We, in addition to fasting, so nothing by mouth from sunup to sundown, so no food, no water, nothing. As we do that, we also read 1/30 of the Quran every day. So we actually read our holy text, especially during the month of Ramadan. We are more observant of prayer. So sometimes, you know, we don't always pray when we're supposed to pray, but during Ramadan we do. And then we observe what it is to give to charity and build for justice. And so that's really what Ramadan is about.
Mm. Yeah, I was blessed to be in Senegal one year during Eid, and it was it was so beautiful. See all these black folks in their Ramadan, in their Eid best, just celebrating. So, Ramadan Mubarak. And we do have a lot to talk about, not all of it so joyous. I had the misfortune of seeing the video from Virginia, the video of this young man, Mr. Oteino, Irvo Oteino, and who was killed by sheriff's deputies and workers inside of the mental hospital there. And it's, I just, it's devastating. There, 10 people are being charged with second-degree murder. This is surveillance video from a state psychiatric hospital. And I know you probably have some insight that I haven't even thought of yet when it comes to this, but I just, it's devastating for me because we think, well, if we get people to mental health professionals instead of law enforcement, they should be safer.
That's right. It's enraging. It's enraging what happened to Mr. Oteino. We know that our Black Lives Matter Richmond chapter is doing work to demand justice for him, but he was smothered to death by deputies. And I think it reminds us, so part of the work is also disentangling law enforcement from areas they don't belong. We don't need police. If we already know he was suffering with a mental health illness, he should have been left to mental health professionals, and there should have been no involvement from police. You know, we see that here when we talk about police being involved. We were with the wife of Takar Smith yesterday at police commission. Her husband was also suffering with a mental health issue. We don't need police. They're not trained to do that. And what I think that we saw and what's starting to come out is because they're not mental health professionals, they themselves get in their feelings and become frustrated and don't know how to deal with folks having a mental health challenge and instead allow themselves to be overtaken and commit criminal acts. And this was a crime. This was an atrocity that they smothered to death Mr. Oteino.
Yeah, it's really, really horrifying. I wish that you don't have to watch it. And I won't be watching it again. He's in handcuffs. He's leg shackled. And he is, he's killed on the tape. They're facing charges. And I know you're an abolitionist, which means no prisons either. But certainly when we see some measure of accountability, that does seem to be a form of progress.
Yeah, so there's 7 involved, and they've all been arrested and charged. We're abolitionists, but we will say as long as there are police in prisons, the first ones who should be in them are the police who kill our people and white supremacists. So until we have the system that we radically imagine, the system should hold accountable police who commit these kinds of atrocities.
When we come forward, I want to talk about Black Lives Matter Grassroots for a little bit, because there continues to be some lingering confusion. But not only that, you have a new board of directors. Want to hear about that. Very interesting, the folks that have come together in support of the boots on the ground for Black Lives Matter. This is KBLA Talk 1580.
She's reclaiming her time on KBLA Talk 1580. More First Things First with Dominique DiPrima when we come forward.
Black women making history at the Oscars. Maisha Cairo here with your K-Black Minute News brought to you by Lendustry. The 95th Annual Academy Awards took place this week, although the show has Black media critics in an uproar. Due to Angela Bassett not winning Best Supporting Actress, we still celebrate costume designer Ruth E. Carter for becoming the first Black woman to win 2 Oscars. Carter has worked on astounding films in the past, such as Selma, Malcolm X, and Spike Lee's School Days. Carter's moment has come again as she has won her second Oscar for Best Costume Design in the Marvel sequel Black Panther: Wakanda Forever. After taking home her win, Carter says she hopes that this can create more opportunities for other women of color in film. I'm Aisha Cairo, and that's your K-Black Minute News.
Hello, this is Dr. Rosie Milligan, self-appointed mayor of South Central Los Angeles, calling authors and business owners, get ready for Black Writers on Tour, plus Business and Tax Expo, Saturday, March 25th, 2023, 10 to 3 p.m. It's a face-to-face event at the Carson Community Center.
Authors, aspiring writers, learn how to write, publish, and sell your book. Business owners, let people know where you're at, and much more. 323-750-3592. It's a free event. You heard right, free. And there's something for everybody. Go to blackwritersontour.com and register today. 323-750-3592.
Literacy is everybody's business. Black Writers on Tour, Saturday, March 25th, 2023, 10 to 3 p.m. I'm looking to see you face to face. 323-750-3592 or visit blackwritersontour.com. Don't miss it.
Hi, it's Lynn Richardson with the Millionaires Roundtable. Have you heard about Lindustry? Come on now. Lindustry is a national black-led small business lender that is headquartered right here in LA. Once you've started your business, Lindustry provides flexible financing options starting at $50,000 to help you access the affordable capital needed to grow. Whether financing is needed to increase working capital, acquire a business, purchase inventory and equipment, or refinance debt, Lindustry has a solution for you. Lending products range from traditional business term loans and lines of credit to SBA 7(a) loans and commercial real estate financing. Lindustry's pre-application process is simple and does not impact your credit score. Visit lindustry.com/KBLA. That's lindistry.com/KBLA to learn more and get started with an application right on the website.
Talk 1580, we do more than just talk.
Hey there, I'm Jared Hill, president of the National Association of Black Journalists of Los Angeles, and I just want to say thank you for the benevolent $10,000 donation and scholarships for the next generation of black journalists.
And I'm Haywood Galbraith, photojournalist and founder of the Minority Photojournalism Institute. Thanks, KBLA, for your generous $10,000 scholarship gift to help us train the next generation of black photojournalists.
Congratulations to all the students who will benefit from the scholarship dollars raised at our Black History Month luncheon, honoring black legends in LA media. When we come forward at KBLA Talk 1580, we're bringing everybody with us. Everybody with us. Everybody with us. Everybody with us. Everybody with us.
The conversation continues right now. Dominique DiPrima on First Things First.
My colleague, the director of Black Lives Matter Grassroots, is on the phone. Dr. Melina Abdullah, before we move on to the board of directors, I got to say congratulations on a wonderful, beautiful Black Women Are Divine celebration, reclamation this year in honor of the angelversary of Breonna Taylor. So wonderful to have her aunt there, Bianca Austin, who spoke, and just the great day that you hosted this year.
That you hosted this year?
Well,
yes.
I am seated. You hosted it.
It was so beautiful, and we're thankful to KBLA for being our media sponsor. We had about 400 folks, 400 black women come out. We're grateful to everybody who contributed. It was, the LA County Federation of Labor is vastly different this year with Yvonne Wheeler as our president. We had the LA County Fed's People's Project giving out produce and gift bags. My girl, Tosca, who owns Glow Girl Got Cosmetics, made sure that everybody went home with free lipstick. We had T-shirts. We had giveaways. We had music, ALLBLK and Maya Jupiter and Ricky Byers. We had poets like Yasmin Monet Watkins. It was just incredible. And let me say, the part that I loved the most was how intergenerational it was. There were girls there. I heard from one of the 16-year-olds who was there for the first time how seen she felt. But there were also so many elders, women in their 70s and 80s, who had never been loved on in that way. The only rule we had was you can't spend any money, right? The black women there couldn't spend any money or bust a sweat doing any work, right? And
but they were dancing. They were dancing.
They were dancing.
They were dancing and singing and, and getting massages and getting counseling. All kinds of things were going on out there. Yoga.
It was incredible. And it also reminds us, we're going to do this every year, but it reminds us we need to make more time to love on each other as Black women and to see each other as Black women. And I still feel filled by that day.
Well, and also, I mean, as much as quiet as it's kept, the brothers came out, right? And you don't hear about the men of Black Lives Matter, but they were out. They were taking care of the women and making sure that they didn't have to lift a finger, erecting the stages, playing the music, handing out the lunches, walking people to their cars. It was really just, and there were kids out there playing. It was just a really, really a nice, beautiful day. Even the sun came out.
It was perfect weather, and the brothers were incredible, incredible. And we don't often shout out, but two of the most beautiful men that I know are Pastor Q and K.O., who keep the music going. At every Black Lives Matter event, they don't take a dollar. This is their commitment to the movement. So they keep the music going. They lift our spirits. And then you got people like Philip and Michael and so many others and Joseph making us feel loved by our brothers. And White People for Black Lives came out and helped. And my students did the Children's Village, so we didn't have to watch our kids. They were lovingly cared for by about 10 students, Latina students from Cal State LA, who made sure that they were loving on Black women.
It was a beautiful day. It was the third annual, I believe, right? I think I've been at all of them.
Yeah.
And it seems it seems like it's growing every year. And so I wanted to take a moment to love on the love that you provided to the community. So we've been talking about how it's important to understand that Black Lives Matter Global Network Foundation is not the same as Black Lives Matter Grassroots, and that in fact Black Lives Matter Grassroots really is Black Lives Matter. And now Black Lives Matter Grassroots has a board. Tell me why and tell me who.
Yes. So, you know, we had been functioning as kind of a part of the same organizing, because we didn't imagine that someone would try to swoop in and steal what belongs to the movement, what belongs to the people, what was built off names like Breonna Taylor and George Floyd and Dejan Kizzee and Fred Williams. We didn't think that anyone would do that, but that's what happened. And so we had to build a new legal structure for the boots on the ground that really is Black Lives Matter. Black Lives Matter Grassroots is the movement side of things. And so we incorporated a new entity. We're waiting on our 501c3 determination letter. But as we do that, we also had to think about what kind of people do we want directing our work and visioning the organization. So we named five people to the board. I feel very fortunate and honored to be chair of the board and to be working alongside Hank Jones, who is a member of the San Francisco 8. He's a Black Panther, and he's Baba to so many of us, a former political prisoner. He's on the board for his vision and strength and history. We have Deanna Hardy Joseph, who's the mother of Andrew Joseph III, who's been in this work since 2014 when her son was killed in Tampa, Florida, as a result of sheriff's misconduct. We have Andrea Foggy Paxton, who is well-known in our building because she once worked for the Tavis Smiley Foundation, but does a lot of work, has made her name in the realm of Black philanthropy. And so she's on our board. And finally, Dorcas Gilmore, who is a former associate director at the NAACP and co-founder of the Baltimore Black Workers Center, where she's also a law professor at Georgetown. And so that's our board. And we will put our board up against any board anytime. It's brilliant, committed, beautiful Black people with a track record of doing work for Black liberation.
Right. So for those confused, this is the I guess, codification or the formalization of Black Lives Matter, which started as a, you know, decentralized, loose network. And now, over time, over these years, and the conflict with the foundation, the money side, shows how important it is to have some kind of structure, right? Dr. Abdullah?
Yes, can you?
Yeah, I hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, and, you know, we were kind of forced into this. But I think that sometimes God directs us and says, okay, you do have to formalize. You're almost 10 years in. You do have to formalize. And, you know, that's what we're doing. But we're doing it in a way that's really thoughtful and builds upon many generations of Black liberation struggle.
Well, congratulations on a solid new board and on an amazing iteration of Black Women Are Divine. And so appreciate you checking in this morning.
Thank you so much for having us, and looking forward to seeing everybody at 4 o'clock at 1313 West 8th Street as we end police association.
Yes, indeed. Tavis Smiley is up next, but you knew that. I'm Dominique DiPrima. History is now, and we're making it together. Until tomorrow, one love.
KBLA 1580 Santa Monica.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Mike Moore. Here's the latest from the Black.